really excited to see you guys here today. And I'm really excited for the guest that's going to be joining us because I think she's going to help us drill down in a big way on some of our 2022, our goals, our expectations for ourselves, for the lives that we want to live both in work and in our personal lives. So holy moly, it's going to be a good one. But first and foremost, some housekeeping. If you are new here, please don't worry about taking notes. Dara is going to be joining us soon, and she is going to be spitting a lot of fire at us. And I don't want you frantically freaking out, thinking that you are going to be desperate for notes. So if you would like notes, you can go to sendmenotes.com, and the notes will magically be sent to you by magical elves, aka us. But, you know, magical elves, let's go with it. So if you would like the notes from this talk, please go to sendmenotes.com, and they will be sent to you. But in the meantime, this is interactive. This is not like your typical Q&A webinar where you have to wait to the end. If you have questions, if you have comments, if there's something you're like, hey, Dara, I want to know about that. Or hey, Kim, let's follow up. That is what the chat is for. Drop it in the chat and we will incorporate your thoughts in real time here with us. Everyone has a seat at this table. We are all in the same cozy coffee shop together. So let's raise our glasses and please help me welcome Dara to coffee with us.
Raising my glass of water. Hey, Kim.
I love it. How are you?
Good. I am loving this global coffee shop and particularly interested in meeting these magical elves.
Ah, we have a little magical elf bunch over here. So I'm super excited to be here with you because when I was thinking about like December and setting myself up for success for the new year, I was just like, it's you. Like that's you. That's your whole gist. I always tell people, hopefully they have Google stalked you. Like Google stock is wonderful. You can literally go to dara.co.com and do a little Google stalking now to catch up. But I was excited because I feel like your whole, like your slogan and like the words that you live by, which is design your life, build a business to fund it and a network to support it. Like that's what we all want for January. Like that's what we all want for 2022. So is this like your busiest time of the year? Because everyone's like, yes, Dara, I want those things.
You know, interestingly, it's usually pretty consistent throughout, but I do think that there is something about the cyclical nature of a year that puts people at the end where we feel quite reflective and we begin to do this sort of matching of where did I actually get towards the things that I desired and where is it that I hope to go? Where's the dissonance? Where's the concordance? And sort of put some light bulbs on for people. So whether it's now, whether it's a quarter from now, you know, we all kind of have to meet ourselves where we are. But this can be a really great time when the world slows down. There's really sort of, and this is where the woo-woo part of me starts to show, but there really is something to the collective energy that we all sort of go into this place of hibernation at this time of year and slow down and connect and re-engage with ourselves in a different way. So it can be a really great time to have these conversations.
Well, and I always feel like when it does slow down a little bit, you are kind of left with your thoughts, which some of us, when we're really, really busy and the year's going crazy, you can kind of ignore or brush to the side. But then it's like Thanksgiving and Hanukkah and Christmas, like things start to slow down. Email starts to like slow down a little bit. And then all of a sudden you're left with like all your thoughts and you're like, oh wait, how long have these been sitting here for?
Yeah, it can be a very scary place for people. I remember the first time, so this is very off topic, but in college, I was a double major. One was in religious studies, and they forced us to do a gamut of world religious experiences, which was such a gift. And one of them was like trying every type of meditation you could ever imagine, from like Zen Buddhist to on and on and on. And I remember some of the first times I did that and how daunting it felt to be like, I'm just supposed to sit here quietly and let my mind wash me over with all of my crazy zany thoughts. And what I didn't yet understand was how much of a gift that was. And that ultimately, if we can't be in that place of stillness with ourselves, we're never going to really hear our own true wisdom. And we are never fully going to be fulfilled or at peace in any other environment if we can't first find that with ourselves.
Oh, 100%. I'm so curious. So like when you have people like me who are coming to you in December and being like, okay, I know that I should spend the next couple of weeks thinking about my goals. I know I should spend the next couple of weeks. I hate the word New Year's resolution, but like, let's go with it for a second, like setting the New Year's resolution, or even today I was on, I'm so happy Gabby is here, because I was on a daily huddle this morning with Steve Nolenberg's team. And we were talking about like having a word, like an intention or like a word for the year, like fierce or, you know, whatever it is. But like, how do you even, like, if I know I need to do all those things, where do you suggest that people start? Like, there's so much, like, where do we even begin?
I'm glad you said that, because I am a big believer in having mantras for one's year, because goals or having like a list of resolutions or anything that becomes cumbersome becomes really easy to forget and push off. Doesn't mean that you can't make them, but when you do, it's really important to sort of make them actionable. So putting them in a calendar or doing things along those lines, that don't just put them on a piece of paper in your Google Drive and they become something that you can actually enact consistently, is great. But the reason I like mantras, and I'm so glad that you and those guys brought that up, is because it gives you a feeling and it gives you something to buoy yourself to. And I think ultimately, we often think we know where we want to go, but there's this difference when we say, like, my mantra is fill in the blank. Like, so some years for me, my mantra, and I usually have around 1 to 3, depending on the year. Sometimes it's been stillness or peace or joy or connection or abundance or, you know, fill in the blank for you. But not only do those things allow you to sort of bucket where your goals are because you want to align with them, this is going to drive us right to values too. Look at what you're doing here. You're such a pro. It ultimately also allows you to really course correct as you're going. So instead of being like, and I am this kind of person, and knowing what I know of you, Kim, I would not be surprised if you are too, that often when we set our mind to a goal, we just drive so steadfastly towards it, regardless of if it's taking us off the path of our true intention and design for it in the first place, or we're the type of like, well, I said I was going to do it, come hell or high water, it's going to happen. And you're like, I'm not enjoying this at all. I don't actually want this outcome anymore. I've like learned enough to know it's not what I want, but hey, I said I was going to do it, so I'm going to do it. Versus a mantra, or even, I mean, in general, what I am talking about is having non-attachment to the outcomes that we put for ourselves. But I think what a mantra does is it gives us that North Star to go back to, which is exactly what values do. It gives us this place to say, where am I finding myself in alignment with this North Star or not? And where do I need to course correct and get back towards it? So I'd say that's the first place. For anyone who wants like a real detailed step, there's actually 6 parts to year planning, goal planning, visioning, mantra creation that I have as a free resource on my website. You can just go to dara.co/freebies. There's like a whole treasure trove of free things, but that one's on goal planning. And it'll give you a lot of real details and some real like templates that you can use to figure out, what is it I desire for myself? What do I want my year to look and feel like? How do I narrate that into a bigger feeling? And that's this part of the feeling I keep coming back to. And I will say to anyone who's like, ah, that's not my style, that was not my natural style either. I am very much like an analyzer, intuitive sort of hybrid. And I'd say the thing I'm most proud of in my life is getting more in touch with my feelings. So for anyone who feels that creating any sort of life plan or goals or otherwise in concordance with a feeling, and if that doesn't feel, again, connected to you, the reason is that ultimately, energetically, we can really create things from that place of feeling. And so when you can connect yourself or buoy yourself to that, that can really drive us forward regardless of the specific designations.
And then I'm curious, you know, when you are thinking about these sort of mantras or intentions, do any of them come with like sub bullet points? Like if my mantra was something like, I'm making this up, more free time, you know, I want more free time. Would the subsets be like, I don't know, like get a side hustle that provides passive income? Or like, I guess when you have your mantra of like, I want more free time, how do you then kind of work backwards, or I guess like action items to get like to achieve that mantra? Like whether that's starting the Etsy store or the side hustle or something that you think will buy you more free time, I guess, in that way.
Yeah. So I would probably even drill down one step below the free time to like, what is it really? Is it freedom and flexibility? Is it like, you know, whatever that true feeling is beyond that, and make that the mantra, and then go and drill into the specifics that you're talking about, which would be sort of the goals of like, okay, if I want freedom and flexibility, what does that mean? Okay, I want more free time. Well, where is my time going right now? Which, you know, Kate and I, you've had, Kate Rose now on your program before, and she and I run a program together, and she talks about the purse dump. This is sort of akin to the purse dump in the sense of it's just doing an audit of where your time is going using this specific example in this case. So you would say, okay, during my day, do I really just like want to look at where I'm spending my time? Where are the places that it is going? And are these places that I really feel are in alignment with the values and the mantras in this case that are what I purport are the things that I want? So if it's time and you're saying, okay, well, I don't need to spend 3 hours a day on social media if that's not actually moving me closer to my goals, maybe I want to limit that. Maybe you're saying, oh, maybe I should hire and outsource some things from my plate, or I should delegate or create systems, and that's going to free up some of my time. Maybe it's saying no to a commitment that you had that once felt aligned and no longer does. Maybe it's saying no to friendships and time with friends in ways that you had before that maybe you'd say quality over quantity in this stage of my life. Like, all of those things can adjust and change based on what those are. But I think what you're getting at is really important, that part of what I talk about in these sort of six different components of goal setting and that free resource I mentioned are that it's important to hit these different designations, that having that sort of higher arching thing around mantras is helpful because it gives us the thing to grasp onto on a day-to-day basis and have our mind continue to connect back to it, almost like setting our intentions each day to connect with it. Versus when you get into the drill down section of the goal planning, which then you write as a narrative, so you feel it all living together in a living, breathing thing that isn't compartmentalized like it is on paper, that feels more like the expanded version of your life. It helps us really understand the embodiment of it and how that would feel to truly be living in the reality of what we say we want and see and try it on and see how that feels. And that also allows us to begin the creation process of it. So all of those pieces are important, and to start from the top down helps. But ultimately, this is exactly what's in alignment with sort of my philosophy that you so generously shared earlier, which is you have to start with the life design piece before you get to the career or the business that you want to create. Because when you know what you want, when you know what you want your time allocations to be, when you know what that costs, because ultimately, when you say, okay, these are the things that I want, and to live that life, and you put true dollar values next to the cost of that life, I will spoiler alert this, most people find that their dream life costs significantly less than they think it will, which becomes tremendously freeing, because then you look at your circumstances and you say, what's the chasm between where I am and where I want to be financially and with my time? Because those are usually the two biggest things that people feel constricted by. And then you reverse engineer everything else and say, well, where do I turn the dial up? Where do I turn the dial down? Where do I keep things the same? And you take little bits at a time and recognize that you don't eat the whole elephant in one bite, as they say, and you figure out what's the hierarchy of priority and how do I begin to take steps by steps to move me in its direction.
And I will say, like, for anyone who is just joining and who didn't do like their Google homework, Google stalking on Dara, it's not, I should say, she is not saying this from a place of theory. You know, she has started not one, not two, not three, but four businesses, one of which she successfully sold and exited from. So I have got to imagine that a lot of this you learned, unfortunately, as like a trial by fire. Like, you started a life and then you were like, I hate this. What have I created? I've created a monster and now I'm living in it. So I wanted to say that for anyone who might be sitting there thinking like, well, you know, Dara doesn't understand where I'm at. Like, please, she most definitely does and has done it, you know, four times over. But as you start to think about like getting quiet and listening to yourself and like creating those mantras and creating that six-part system to really go after your goal, I really like this point that Jeff brings up, which is if you have trouble kind of getting quiet, or if you have trouble really sitting with your own thoughts, what are some tips or tricks or tactics that you use, or that maybe you give to your clients to use, to help them get quiet so that they can start to have some of those thoughts and feelings bubble up?
Yeah, thanks for asking this question, Jeff. And by no means am I a master at meditation or teaching it. I did have the great joy of teaching a 33-part digital series with the master Deepak Chopra. And he taught me so much that we were able to share with the world about so many things. But one of the things that I remember so clearly from us talking about a similar topic was that that's not actually the goal. Like the goal is to just be there with yourself and to let it be exactly what it is. So whatever arises is exactly what needs to happen. And this is the ultimate sort of meta universe of the idea of non-attachment in real life, regardless of one's belief set. I think we all understand that when we hold so tightly to something, we create unnecessary resistance as opposed to allowing things to be how they are and not attaching or judging what that circumstance is, because ultimately our experience of the situation is entirely based on our reaction and perception to and of it. So in that case, yes, certainly we can feel a more pleasurable experience in meditation when our mind feels clear, but only will that truly happen consistently and continuously when we are enlightened, which I don't know anyone who's enlightened because I'd imagine they're no longer on this planet. I think there's some sort of graduation that happens somewhere else. I don't know. But ultimately, it's about just recognition of that and just saying to oneself, oh, there's another thought. Thank you. Like, let it pass and go back. One of the things that I found for myself is when I have something that I can connect to that doesn't distract me from the moment, whether it's just in and out breaths, and you know, it can be just recognizing your inhale and exhale. It can be taking a mantra like we've been talking about and just saying like, breathe in love, breathe out judgment, breathe in, you know, it can be whatever you want it to be. It can be listening to a guided meditation. I do transcendental meditation most often, which means they give you a Sanskrit mantra. There's so many different ways to do it. None is better or worse than the other. It's just about what works for you and what allows you to be in a place, even just for a moment, of being with oneself and gifting yourself that opportunity and not even feeling like it needs to be a linear trajectory of improvement. That was something that really stumbled me for a long time, where I felt like, you know, when I started to get into this, it was so easy and like I could feel certain things right away and it would feel so peaceful and calming. And then, you know, a metaphor that I heard for meditation and the sort of levels and layers that one goes into that has really helped me is going into a cave. And ultimately, when you step into the first entrance of a cave, and stay with me on this, it's dark and it's cold and it feels peaceful. And that's sort of what happens when one starts to get into the first levels of meditation, because you haven't been there before and it feels kind of restful. Maybe, maybe not. But the deeper you get into oneself and one's subconscious, the more you're kicking up dirt as you go deeper into this cave, the more you're awakening the bats and the sleeping animals in there. And so you're actually doing it exactly right. But so much is we're digging up the deeper that we go that it feels like we're doing the opposite. So again, it just comes back to this place of giving ourselves grace and allowing that to be a catalyzing point for us in our waking lives and the places where we're not on the cushion, so to speak. And on the cushion is like a very generic term. I meditate on airplanes where it's like loud. I meditate on park benches. I meditate in my bed. Like I meditate wherever I can, just because it's more important that I give it a chance and do it than that I don't do it in the first place. So I think it's like anything, you know, if you've never read the Four Agreements, I'd say this is a great reason to give it a read, because one of the four agreements that this book talks about is that one should always do their best. And at the end of the day, you only know what that is. And so just giving it that try and setting the intention to do it and understanding either the way that it feels and how you see yourself showing up differently, like talking about businesses. My first business was a credit card processing company. I was 25 years old when I started it. That was 13 years ago. I was running myself into the ground. I was chasing everyone else's definitions of success. I was trying to hit all the vanity metrics everyone else said, you know, head counts, dollar volumes, number of states that we grew into, which was 38, but that was very, very challenging. And my adrenals were completely exhausted. I was not making decisions from a great place. Anytime there was a small emergency, I would go off the handle emotionally, which is not, I'm a very calm and centered person most of the time. But that to me was such a recognition of something's not working here. So what I ultimately decided to do was pick up meditation. And I realized how even the one thing alone that I saw a distinction in was my reaction. And that when a problem would arise in my business, that I would sort of step outside of myself instantly and say, how do you work on this? And does this really matter in the long run? And how much energy are you going to give to it? As opposed to what I would do before of like Chicken Little, the sky is falling. So ultimately, at the end of the day, like, or if it's the science that you need to buoy yourself to, but figure out what it is that's going to keep you motivated to do it long enough to get through those hurdles of like, it doesn't feel good. My brain is just talking to me all the time.
100%. And I feel like what's really interesting too, when we start to think about, you know, the things that we should be doing, we should be visualizing, we should be doing meditation, or the goals that we should be hitting, or those vanity metrics that you're talking about, like those career achievements that, you know, we should, or feel like we have to hit. That one thing I wanted to talk about specifically with you today, and specifically because I think it's the opposite when people hear that we're going to be talking about goals, they kind of think about like the bullet points, the to-do list, or like the things that we're going to go after. And what I wanted to bring up that you wrote an entire article about that I actually read before we even met, which I think is like a funny full circle moment, is the beauty of saying no. That part of goal setting is actually perfecting how to say no and saying no to opportunities that might not be like a full bodied yes. And you might think, oh, that's weird. Like we should be moving forward. But in some ways, sometimes achieving your goals means stepping back or saying no to things. And I think we typically think of goals as like a lean forward, go after activity. And you wrote a really beautiful piece around Brené Brown telling you no. And I would encourage anybody who has not read that article, again, I read it before we even met. And then I actually put two and two together and I'm like, that name sounds familiar. And I was like, oh, I read this article and I loved it. But I'm curious, like, what are your thoughts around saying no, like that concept of saying no? And then also, because I know you do private kind of one-on-one coaching as well, is that something that you really have to work with clients at? Or are you more focused on, okay, kind of the more lean forward, like the things they're going after, as opposed to saying like no to things that might be happening in their life?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. Also, Jeff, thanks for letting me know my lighting is good. I have natural lighting coming in and it is really moving with the sun. So thanks for that. It's interesting because ultimately I always tell people that we are all human. So none of us are immune to mindset growth opportunities. And so, you know, my work really sort of intersects this place of life coach and business strategist, because we are full humans and we need to understand what it is we desire, what that why is that underpins the development of our businesses, but that the undercurrent of all of it is always mindset. And for a lot of people, that's boundaries, and no is a big part of that. You know, I think as women in particular, we are socialized to be people pleasers in so many ways and to not ruffle feathers or make waves. And, you know, I was personally raised by a dad who would always say, you know, winners never quit and quitters never win, which made me, what I internalized that to mean as one way was you can't ever stop doing something that you've committed to, which means you grow this list of things that you are forever feeling beholden to that maybe no longer are served by you being a part of them. Maybe they're no longer, you know, serving you. But I felt like, well, I thought that's the way. I thought you make your word is everything. And so you do it forever. But I think like everything, there's shades of gray and there's nuance. And in a world of sound bites and hacks and all these things online, we don't talk about the nuance enough. And so the article that you're referencing was an outreach I did to Brené Brown many years ago. I had created this sort of social movement called Give It Forward. And it was really about sort of this underpinning belief that we all know and feel from anecdotal experience that we feel our best and that we generate the most in life. And we know this through the social science evidence of Adam Grant and his book, Give and Take, when we are of service to other people. The pendulum cannot swing to the point of martyrdom, meaning you can't give to the point of full depletion. However, we have been raised in a culture, if you're in the US, to believe that takers, those who are out for number one themselves, are the winners. But the science tells us the opposite, that those who give win, not only in like empirical ways, but also in the way that they feel. And so I created this Give It Forward movement that was really about reaching out to one person in one's network or community every day and offering to be of service with no strings attached. And if they wanted to give it forward to someone else, then great. And it was this thing that whenever I do it, I typically do it for like 30 days intentionally. And, you know, certainly we all show up doing it by happy accident in our lives, but to do it every single day by design was this beautiful thing. And so, you know, hundreds and thousands of people began to do it alongside me. And I heard Brené Brown talking about some of this science as well. And I was like, oh, maybe Brené wants to be a part of this movement. There, you know, for me, it was just nothing beyond more people should be giving in the world. And there's a lot of good that comes from it. And I got this email that you then read. I shared it exactly in this Forbes article. That was the best no I'd ever gotten. And it really set me free to say, wow, This is a model for how to say no and do it with integrity and humanity towards the other person without burning a bridge, but really honoring both of us. And some of the like high level stuff that she did that and you can certainly just Google Dara Forbes saying no, Brene Brown, and you'll find it. But one of my favorite things about it was that first she honored what I had asked in the first place. She basically said, you know, I love what you're doing with blank. So she didn't just like brush past that. Then she said, currently my three priorities are 1, 2, and 3. And I think it was like family, teaching, and research or something like that. And she said, so anything else I'm not able to say yes to at this time. And then she basically sort of didn't slam the door in my face, but she just sort of, you know, honored that maybe we would reconnect in the future. I can't remember her exact language, it's just several years ago. But ultimately it left me feeling like, wow, she really was gracious in this interaction and left me feeling like I was seen, that she didn't just ignore it. Cause I think that's most people's tendency to say, I'm just gonna ignore it because I'd rather do that than say no. But I would actually rather emphasize that if we can create a culture where people say no in that way, where she never actually had to say the word no, because a lot of people are just afraid of using that word in the first place, that we then continue to create this catalyzing effect, just like the Give It Forward movement, of showing other people and modeling what it's like to say no generously, and that they can thus do the same. And I think ultimately, it doesn't mean you will go by unscathed. I have had many instances, but I'd say proportionally, it's probably, you know, 1% of the time where people still react in a way that is very triggered, I'll say, by my saying no. And I think we've all experienced that, which is often why we bury our heads and we don't say no, and we say yes to things that we don't want, or we ignore and we brush it under the rug. But at the end of the day, we just remember that other people's reactions to us sometimes are the, you know, it's in some way affected by our words, our actions, and we have to take responsibility for how our intentions land. However, we also have to understand that's coming from their place and that they have whatever they're going on in their head. That's their own perspective and experience. And that shouldn't mean that we then have to change our mind. Because at the end of the day, when we're saying no to something, it's coming on the heels of some sort of question. It's coming on the idea of someone either asked you for something or you've been saying yes because you've been showing up to something. And when those circumstances are the case, we still have the right to either change our mind in the case of the latter or in the case of the former to say, this doesn't suit me well. And actually to do it from a place of lovingness and saying, my not being able to commit to this fully actually is in your favor to know that now rather than having me be involved and water down the efficacy of what it is you're asking for in the first place. And the last thing I'll say about it, and I love that people are saying like, no is a complete sentence. Absolutely. Is that at the end of the day, like we don't have to say yes to everything, and we're doing ourselves a favor by that. And that when we create space for the things that are actually true yeses, we have so much more efficacy in those things than spreading ourselves super thin.
Well, and I think it's saying no to the things that you're exactly right are not necessarily going to be serving you either at this moment or where you want to be. You know, it's making room for the things that you're going to anticipate in the future. I think that, you know, definitely, I think we're all a little bit guilty sometimes of not thinking about, well, what about in the next 3 months? Like, sure, I'll sign up to, you know, volunteer. Sure, I'll sign up for the kids PTA. And you don't think like, well, sure, I have time for it right now, but am I going to have time for it in 3 months? Or am I going to have time for it in 2 months? And the answer to that sometimes is a no. And then you're right. It gets watered down. And then like, nobody's happy. Saying no is hard.
Well, I was going to say, if I may, Scott made a really great point in the comments. And what that can often mean is that you can pass that opportunity on to someone else. You can point them to a resource. Like, there are other ways to get to what someone might need without you having to say yes on the terms that were exactly laid out.
Oh, no, 100%. It's a really good point to think about it as potentially an opportunity for someone else or an opportunity for a connection that you might know. I'm curious, you know, you talked a little bit or referenced rather your work with Deepak, but you know, he's not your only sort of like A-list person that you've interacted with or worked with. There's, you know, Adam Grant, there's Bobby Brown, Seth Godin, et cetera. I'm curious for you, like being able to have access to these individuals and seeing maybe their goals or their roadmaps or, you know, how Deepak thinks about growing his brand. You know, what are some like secrets or insights that you could let us in on as we think about our goals in our 2022 that might be helpful or the way that in which they think about things you found was particularly like surprising or useful?
Yeah, absolutely. So one is I think that they are all exceptional at determining what it is they want to say yes and no to. And this is hilarious. And doing that without abandon. And sometimes for them, they have, well, in many cases or all cases, they have the real bonus of having sort of a buffer around them of other people to do that for them, which becomes a helpful bonus in many cases because they don't have to feel like the bad guy or gal. But one thing that Deepak shared with me very early on, which I found so fascinating because he's someone that like has billions of people paying attention to what he's doing, is that he said the way he makes decisions is threefold. He said, ultimately, sorry, I'm like really messing up this lighting. Is that he said, is the thing fun to do? Is the person or people I'm going to do it with enjoyable to be with? And will it make an impact in a way that aligns with the work that I want to do? And if the answer is yes to all of them, he will absolutely do it. If it is yes to two of them, he'll think about it. And if it's yes to one or less, he won't do it. And I was like, that's so interesting because it's such an easy filter for us to run things through. And it also is interesting because you don't usually think of, quote, highly successful people, which I have a problem with my own statement because I think ultimately we should define success for ourselves. It's like the crux of my belief system in the first place, and that we get sidewinded entirely when we take outside influence to be the thing that we drive our success towards. It's exactly what threw me for a loop in the early stages of my business building. But that being said, when you see someone who has this external trappings of success, I would say for Deepak, in any way one might define success, he has it, especially from like the internal peace and fulfillment and impact stance. But you rarely hear people talk about the enjoyment part. You really hear them talk about the hustle, the grind, the burnout, the, you know, whatever metrics and ROIs they can talk about. But for him to have his first two things be about the thing being enjoyable and the people he's collaborating with being enjoyable to be with, that really resonated with me. And I was like, wow, we can like all give ourselves permission to really think that way. And, you know, the third pillar of what my whole belief system is on the network to support the work that we're doing, because one, we can go a lot further and have a lot more fun when we do it in community. And it's really silly of us to think that we can do everything independently and on our own and that we can't go faster and further and all these other things without it. But it really, you know, it just makes you recognize like, we need each other, but why not at least be really, really thoughtful about the people that you let into your orbit? And one of the things that I've learned through all of the work I've done in the space of like teaching about networking and relationship building, community building, is learned about something that many people probably heard about, which is Dunbar's number. Robin Dunbar is a scientist and anthropologist who did this study on the number of human connections that we can actually have at any given time. And on average, it's 150. And it starts with your immediate inner circle of five, which are the people who influence you the most. It's very akin to Jim Rohn's, you are the average of the five people with whom you spend the most time. But those are the people that are, you know, the person that you're in a one-on-one relationship if you're monogamous. It's the, you know, your deepest, closest friends or family that are around you all the time. The next concentric circle around that is 50. They're the people you're probably inviting to birthday parties and dinner parties and seeing semi-regularly. And then the circle on the outside of that is 100. And those are the people that you maybe see once a year, once a quarter, something like that. You invite them to your wedding. Hopefully you're having yours soon, Kim. And fingers crossed. And when we think about it that way, we recognize, well, if I can only really maintain about 150 relationships at a time, give or take everyone else just as a part of your CRM and your social media network, that one, we recognize that it's okay to have these seasons and stages where we move people in and out of different points of our life, and that that is not unkind, that it is actually kinder to you and to them to understand that you only have so much bandwidth, so why not commit fully, just like the no's we were talking about before. And two, to realize if I only have that many and I really have that five and that 50 that are really the most influential to me and the way that I'm going to be shaping myself and the ripple effects that that has on my work and my impact, then why not at least enjoy them? Like, why not at least make them be the people you like? And that is so counterculture to like the company I sold recently was a networking events company. And the whole ethos behind ours was that it was about who you are before what you do, because so much of the world tells you just go out and care about people's titles, about what they can do for you, about who they know, about the doors they'll open, blah, 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 blah. And I hated that Because at the end of the day, we are so much more than what we do, even if it is a huge part or extension of who we feel we are. But we are ever evolving. And if we judge people on that, then we are missing so much. But what comes with a lot of those misconceptions around network and network building are that we should just grin and bear it and deal with the people that we don't enjoy being around at all. But ultimately, I would say do the opposite.
Well, and I think Jeff makes such a good point. Like, it is all about community. Like, if you get a good community, I always say, like, if you are surrounded by awesome humans, like, you're doing something right. Like, that is, at the end of the day, what really, I think, drives us all forward and makes us excited about work or about what we're doing. It's really about, like, how do we get that awesome human energy around us?
Yes.
More often.
Exactly. And honestly, that energy is contagious. Like, when the idea, I see this Hart Jim Rohn reference from David, to that point of you become the average of the people that you surround yourself with, it happens statistically with weight, with earnings, with, you know, personal character traits. It happens with all of these things. So it matters. But there was a question earlier, I think from Stuart, if I can't remember, it's farther up in the chat, but about how one should consider their mindset around hearing no. And if you similarly just want to Google, and maybe the genies behind here, the magic elves, will pop it up. But if you just Google Forbes, like, hearing no in my name, I have an entire article on how to respond to hearing no, because we are not generally very good at it.
Interesting. Well, nobody likes that. Nobody likes a no. Everyone wants a yes.
Yes. I mean, until you realize that those no's are helping you get exactly where you need to be and where you're going. I mean, in all these different ways. Like, I mean, I could go on and on with stories of them, but even that Brené Brown one, it wasn't what I wanted to hear, but that's okay. It just kind of kept me moving and I learned so much from it.
I mean, it's one of those things too, where I feel like, you know, Zakiya makes such a great point. Like, you have to bring joy even into the situations that you say yes to. And I think that that's one thing that I was really excited, you know, to talk to you about with 2022 coming up, is like, how do we bring in joy? How do we bring in excitement about the new year and not like, oh, the new year is coming, like another year older, which I know sometimes it can be the vibe of like the new year's resolutions. It can feel like, I don't want to do that. And so really like having you come on and kind of gut punch us with like, how do we bring in more excitement and more joy about 2022? So I'm curious for you, like, with a lot of the private clients that you work with and your private coaching, is there something that you think that across everyone that you work with is sort of like a universal struggle? Like, anybody who walks in your door, like, they seem to always be asking about this, and like, what is that and how can we start to solve it if we're experiencing it as well?
So I'm going to answer your question, but it's not going to be exactly what you're asking for. So there's three things that I hear over and over and over again, and it's people are struggling with confidence, consistency, and clarity. It just so happens that there are three C's. And it's interesting because I work with people sort of at three intersections of their life. One is they are looking to find their path in the first place. The second is they want to start a business. And the third is they're growing their business, but their business is running them instead of them running their business. And they want to invert it, understandably. And it's interesting because no matter where I am meeting them in that trajectory, those three words come up every single time. And then certainly there's words around not feeling fulfilled or feeling burned out or, you know, wanting to get their time back. Those are all consistent too. But at the end of the day, I think the confidence piece is really interesting because it's non-gendered. Like, it comes he, she, and they. People feel that consistently. And I think it has so much to do with how much we compare ourselves to others. It has so much to do with us looking at these, like we talked about, generic metrics of success that we often think that we have to chase. So much is our socialization from our family and our communities. And when we can really dive into, well, what is it that I uniquely want for myself? And what are the gifts and skills that I'm bringing to the table to get myself there? And then how do I create a community to support me around that and help open the doors to create the success I'm seeking on my own terms? The confidence builds, because ultimately I always think that action is the kryptonite to confidence, or lack of confidence for more appropriately. Because ultimately, when our mind is focused on moving in the direction of progress, not perfection, but progress, it sort of pushes out and and diminishes the flame or extinguishes it altogether of those silly voices in our head. Because that's the other piece. And, you know, we had questions around mindset, which I think are so beautiful. Because at the end of the day, we can't give credence to every thought that we have. We have 30 plus thousand thoughts a day on average, and not all of them are true. Most of them are not true. And so we ultimately get to decide which ones are we going to put credit onto and which ones are we going to really lean action into. And then the consistency, I think, is the interesting piece, because those two are very married. If you're taking action and you can do it consistently and you can map it up to the goals, to the life design, to the values, then if that's happening consistently, the confidence is going to build, because you're going to see the muscle building. You're going to see the progress. You'll have more in your mirror so that you can look back and say, wow, like, look at all that I have accomplished and done, which builds the confidence in and of itself. So I think what we often do is we compare ourselves on like our first lap to people on their 10th or 100th lap. And then we think, well, of course I'm not doing as well as they are, when really we don't know the behind the scenes. We don't know what they are working with. We don't know what they're feeling. We don't know what they're experiencing, nor does it even matter, because if it's not helping you get where you want to go, then quiet that, don't pay attention, don't listen in the first place.
No, it's so true. And I'm really like thankful to like be hearing this, especially on December 1st. I hope everybody else is with me on the December 1st. Like, this is like the perfect timing to be like hearing some of these messages loud and clear. So we're getting to like my favorite part, which is kind of like the caffeine speed round questions, which are selfishly my favorite, because we just copy all your homework and then we use it for our own. So
great.
Are you ready?
I hope so. Let's find out.
Okay. Is there something that you have started using or doing lately that you absolutely love? It could be like an app that you really love, or maybe it's a product or a practice, or I don't know, Taekwondo or something, but like, is there something that you've been doing that you're like, this is amazing?
Yeah. And actually I stole it from Kate Rose now, because when we have video calls, she's doing it. And I'm like, I hate working out, even though my mom was a bodybuilder, fun fact. And it is, she found this treadmill that's just the base, and that it's, we use that with a standing desk, or I've configured my desk to become a standing desk. And I walk on it for the first hour and a half while I'm doing email, because fun fact, we should really schedule our days and our systems around our energy fluctuations. And I know that I am what Daniel Pink's book, When, talks about as an owl, where my best energy is in the afternoon hours. So I do my lowest cognitive load work in the morning, and I walk on my treadmill and usually get 7,000, 8,000 steps in, get a little sweat going, my energy rises. This is blasphemous in your space, but I don't drink coffee, so it's sort of my coffee jolt in the morning. Oh, hilarious. Okay, well, I can join you on some tea, but yes, this treadmill, if anyone wants it, DM me, I'll send it to you. It was like a $300 investment that has been one of the best things that I've done for myself.
Okay. We're all going to be sending you the DM about the magic treadmill. So I am very excited about that. It looks like Ellen is also a fan of Daniel Pink's work. So Ellen, you're a fan of Daniel Pink. I'm a fan of this treadmill already. So we already know that that's going to be a good one. What is the next thing that you're hoping to learn? That's kind of like on your to learn list, whether it's like a language or maybe like a new app or program, just something that you're excited to like dig into a little bit more.
So this is a really hard question for me, because we didn't talk explicitly about values, but my second highest value is growth and learning. So I'm constantly devouring the world as like a curious being. And I think I literally read 6 or 7 books this week alone. So I am constantly in this. And I would say the first part of my answer is, I say I want to learn Spanish, but I'm not actually going, I'm not going to do what it takes to do it. So the sort of the like pretend thing that I want to learn, but what I actually really want to learn is more about the psychology of personal identity.
Oh, how are you going to learn about that?
Reading.
Reading. Okay. Are there any books that you've like automatically flagged?
I haven't yet. I've read a bunch of books on like positive psych and all sorts of like different psych and soch and anthro types of books, but I haven't nailed it. So if anyone has any recommendations, put them in the chat for me or DM me, because I'm going to start devouring those next.
I like that. I don't know what it's about. All I know is I did see that Brené Brown released a book yesterday, and I thought of you because I was like, how cosmic. She released a book, Atlas of the Heart. I have no idea what it's about. Maybe an atlas, maybe a heart. I don't really know what it's about, but I did see that she had new books. We might have to add that to the reading list.
I'll definitely check that one out. I love her books.
I know, they're pretty good. Well, you mentioned the sort of like five people that you spend the most time with and your circle of influence, but I'm curious for you, you know, obviously with these crazy things, we also follow a lot of digital people in whether it's Instagram or LinkedIn or like various spaces. And I'm curious if there are a few accounts, they can be individuals, like I really like XYZ person, or they could be like companies or brands that you follow that you just feel like, I don't know, they just kind of like light you up. Like they give like a little spark when it comes scrolling across your screen.
Well, I'm obviously going to assume you're off the table. So in addition to following Kim, so this is actually interesting. I'm glad that you asked this question because so many people feel an aversion towards social media because ultimately it's a tool that, depending how we use it, is sort of our experience with it. And it can become a cesspool and it can become this like really negative place. So I'm super intentional to make sure that the people that show up in my feed and my social media of choice, and this feels a little blasphemous because I know we're on LinkedIn and Facebook right now, is Instagram. And I'm also like an elder millennial, so I've never actually been on TikTok. I can't speak to it at all, nor Snapchat. So on my Instagram, I've curated it to be a place where when I get on, in addition to like my clients and my actual friends, I only follow accounts that I know are going to be really positive and uplifting. And one of my favorites is called Moon Omens. And it's like all these really like positive, aspirational, inspirational things every day where it's like a little bit astrology, but not really. And it just kind of gives you a jolt of like, yeah, like that's great. And so I really like that. And then I love Adam Grant stuff. I just think he is so good at succinctly in like 1 to 3 phrases, knocking you over the head with a way to think about something you haven't thought about it in your professional life and how it also usually, we're not separable people. So how it also integrates into your outside of work life. So those are two accounts that I really love.
And then I'm curious for you, like, as we were talking about mantras or some people pick words, you know, word of the year, I think Oprah does that. What do you have those figured out for yourself for 2022? Or could you share one of them if you don't have all of them figured out?
I haven't. And I'm actually trying to think back. So the end of 2019, I typically take the week between Christmas and New Year's to do a deep dive. I have this practice that I'd highly suggest to other people. So my birthday is in mid-November, and I always do this public facing blog because it holds me accountable of my year in review of what I did, what I learned, how things like tracked. And it's really interesting because we are so quick to forget what happened and what transpired. And I spend typically 10 to 20 hours creating it. It, you know, I go through my calendar, my photos, my social media, my journals, like you name it, to figure out like, what was I thinking? What was I experiencing? What was I feeling? And then that allows me to have this springboard into that week at the end of the year where I'm really sitting with like, what did I learn? What do I want this year to be, look, feel like? And the year going into 2020, so end of 2019, spaciousness and surrender were my two words. And then obviously we all know what happened. And I was like, ooh, be careful what you wish for. Like, it was like the most spaciousness we've all ever had from one another. And we absolutely had to surrender to exactly what was going on. But so answer is no, I haven't made those yet. But those are my two words for that year. And actually last year, I don't think I chose to do them. I think that I really was in this headspace of we were thrown for such a loop and we all learned to iterate so well to survive that I felt like, let me just really deeply practice this idea of letting whatever be and just go with it. And last year I chose to just completely keep the slate clean. This year I'll see what that's like. So follow up with me in a month.
If somebody wanted to go look at your old ones and like copy your homework there, are they still publicly available?
They are. They're on a blog. It's embarrassing. It's on a blog that I started when I was 23, I think. And no one has ever asked me this question, so you're welcome. And it's called The Betwixter. And the reason I named it that was because it combined the words betwixt and twixter, which generally kind of combined to mean one at a crossroads. So I was sort of at that quarter life phase. I was in that place that a lot of people are in their 20s where they're like, what do I do with my life? What's my purpose? Why am I here? All of that, you know, very trying to move up the Maslowian pyramid to the place of enlightenment. And so back then I actually used it as a way to exercise my writing muscle because I loved writing. But after, you know, years and years of school had really gone to the wayside aside from emails, which is also why I started writing for magazines, because I felt like, well, let me hold myself accountable to doing this because I wanted to have a regular practice. And sometimes when you put yourself on the hook, it's a really good way to keep consistent. But so all that to say, that's kind of where that landed.
All right. So we know we go to research the blog if we want to see a little bit of old school Tara to entertain us. And then, okay, last but not least, like, we love homework. We're very good students. We're like sit in the front, A++ students. If you could give all of us homework for this week, it could be to read something, it could be to do something, it could be to watch something. What would be the homework assignment that you would give all of us to do?
Oh my gosh, there's so many things. Can I give more than one?
You can give more than one.
Thank you, teacher. Okay, so the first one would be to go to the freebies page of my website, because there are so many of these resources that are going to give you tangible tools to take into your new year planning. Thank you, magical elves. You are so good at your job. The second, I don't know why this is coming up for me, but I trust my intuition that someone's going to love this, is I have 3 memoirs that I've read in the past 12 months that have stood out far and beyond. And I'll name all 3 of them, but the one that I'm going to suggest as homework is the last. So my 3 favorite memoirs from the past 3 years. And the reason I love memoirs is I think we can learn so much by someone really, like someone mentioned in the comments before, talking about not just the highlights, but the failures and going into the depths of it. And so when someone does that truly and deeply, I love it. And they talk about so many of the dimensions of their own personal growth journey. So the first favorite was Trevor Noah's. The second was Alicia Keys. And the third, and the one that I really think people should read because it's like really out right now, is Will Smith's. And highly recommend reading any of those books, particularly the last one.
I know a fun fact about the Will Smith book that I thought was an interesting fun fact. You know, Mark Manson, the guy who wrote The Single Art of Not Giving a F-bomb. Apparently he ghost wrote that book.
No, he didn't just ghost write it. He co-wrote it because his name's on the cover page.
Oh, then he wasn't a ghost write. He like,
yeah, I was going to say, for anyone who hasn't wrote it, published or doesn't know, the difference is they both ghost write the book, but one actually gets credit for it and the other one just gets paid, but they don't put their name on the cover.
Interesting. I thought that was an interesting like mix. I was like,
yeah, totally. Huh. And my guess is that Will read the book and figured like, here's someone who can really get it, because in Will's interview with Oprah, which was also great and like by no means as good as the book, but like a highlight reel of it and some Cliff's Notes of it, he brings Mark up and he doesn't talk about their writing process in depth, but he does talk about the interviews that he did with him and how he helped him see that the bridge of his entire story, and this does not ruin anything, I promise, takes him from fear to love, and that really is the human experience. And so each chapter is titled with a feeling, an adjective, and it moves through that throughout the course of it.
I will add one more. I'm not supposed to be giving homework, but I will add another one that I really like. And Giacomo's not here, but he had to leave early, but he will back me up on this. Matthew McConaughey's Green Lights.
I just read that.
Was the best freaking book. I listened to it on Audible. So he was like reading it to me and it was fire. Like I loved it. The bumper stickers, like just everything was
well, so here's good. What he's in Austin, you're in Austin. So there's like a kinship. And 2, I was reading it over Thanksgiving when we took our Airstream to Texas, which was funny because he talks at length about his living in his Airstream and living in Texas. I was like, oh, we're kindred. So yeah, definitely co-sign on that.
I love it. This has been so much fun. Thank you, like times a million. If people want to keep learning from you, keep following you, where is the best place? Like, where do you show up most often? Instagram.
Yeah, Instagram for sure. It's just Instagram. @TaraB. I'm sure the magical elves will hook it up in a second, but I show up most there. And then you can certainly reach out to me and direct message if you have any follow-up questions, need any of those resources, or grab them on my website.
Oh, I love it. And I will add in a plug. We do this every single week, every single Wednesday at 1 p.m. Eastern. If you are new here, if you just joined in, don't worry. You can come every single week. There's always a seat at the table. You can follow me on LinkedIn or you can go to getcoffeewithkim.com and it will magically, we have lots of magical elves. We even have little calendar elves. It will magically add it to your calendar. So you can go to getcoffeewithkim.com and it will be added to your calendar. But Dara, I'm sending you a big cheers. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you all. So such a pleasure to be here, Kent. Thank you and your magical elves and to everyone who was asking great questions and listening so thoughtfully.
Ah, I love it. Well, thanks.